So you have a picture of Sophocles there. That's actually from a statue, I believe, at the British Museum in London. And notice the two little epigraphs, those two little quotes at the beginning. I depict men as they ought to be. And not all things are to be discovered. Many are better concealed. Ignorance is bliss. All right. So we get his dates. You see the map of ancient Greece on 1435. We see the chronology of Sophocles, born in 496 BC. In the year 468, his first triumph over another writer, Aeschylus, in the drama competition at the Festival of Dionysius. In 441, he writes Antigone. Antigone is the second play in his Oedipus trilogy. Okay. Then you have the Peloponnesian War beginning. And in 430, he writes Oedipus the King, the first play in the Oedipus trilogy. And then Oedipus at Colonus, the third play, is produced after he's been dead for about 5 years, okay, in the year 401. I often don't do Oedipus the King, but do Antigone instead, because Antigone, in one sense, and I'm thinking, if we finish Oedipus today, I may throw in Antigone for Monday. Antigone is a very modern play, even though it's written, 2,400 years ago. What do I mean by it's a very modern play? It's about a very modern problem. It is about a perennial problem. And that problem is the rights and responsibilities of the individual versus the rights and responsibilities of the state. It's about, ultimately, do you have to do everything the state tells you to do? Okay, I mean, that is an issue we see daily where people stand up and say, no, I'm not going to do that. Or I disagree with that, or I'm going to protest, that kind of thing. We'll see what happens. Page 1437, you got a few phrases there. Okay? This is talking about the conventions of Greek drama. Orchestra and chorus and skeine and deus ex machina. The orchestra is not all the guys sitting down in front with their instruments. The orchestra is a pit in front of the stage. Okay, not actually a pit, but it's the area where the chorus of a bunch of men does their part of the play. So if you think of the stage as looking like this, right, and it's surrounded, a Greek stage, it's going to be built in terms of an amphitheater. So these are rows of seats, and you've got a picture of one of the famous ones, I think, Ephesus, in your book. The orchestra kind of operates out here. And generally what they do is they have strophes and anti-strophes. They start one side and they wander to the other side. And next time they speak, they wander back to this side. And then they wander back over here, and then they wander. And that's all they do. Okay? And generally their purpose is to give commentary on what is happening. It's almost like they're interpreters for the deaf, like they're sign language, okay? But they're not actually. So they're commenting and interpreting a little bit of what's happened. They sometimes give some exposition, but not always, okay? You have, at the back of the stage, the skeine, or the skein, okay, which is a building that serves as a dressing room that people come in and out of. Sometimes in Greek dramas, Greek tragedies, I should say, the author creates a conundrum, a problem that can't be solved rationally. And so the author uses a deus ex machina, which means literally God from the machine. Okay. It might be a character comes up from the bottom of the stage. By the time Shakespeare's writing his plays, this, if there's a deus ex machina, this character will often be lowered from the heavens. Okay, so they'll come down from above. What does it mean? It means you have some supernatural solution to the human problem. If you saw Age of Ultron, there is a deus ex machina in that film. It's called Nick Fury and his helicarrier. Okay? Because Nick Fury and the helicarriers, they're supposed to be gone at the end of the first Avengers film. But because the problem is so large, it's kind of like Joss Whedon put himself in a corner. It's like, how am I going to solve this problem? How am I going to get the Avengers off this piece of property that's going to poof? Bright idea. We'll bring in a floating aircraft carrier, you know, and solve the problem that way. Okay. Notice, technically, any improbable means by which an author provides a too easy resolution for a story. If you think 1930s cowboys and Indians films, the deus ex machina always was the cavalry rides in at the last moment to save all the white settlers from the nasty Native Americans or the Red Indians. Okay. 1438, you've got the image of the classical Greek theater. Okay. You know, in Greece today, I've got a friend who's Greek. In Greece today, they put on, you know, these plays all summer long in some of these theaters that remain. And the amazing thing about them is the acoustics. You don't have characters who have to shout their lines. They can talk like I'm talking now, and the people in the very back seats, and these aren't seats, they're concrete blocks or stone, okay, can hear them. Okay? Because its design, it rises. Well, sound rises. Okay? 1439. Greek tragedy, I talked about, you know, how drama is usually divided into acts. The Greek tragedy is divided into five parts. Okay? You have the prologue. I don't remember how to spell them. The parados. Okay, so the prologue is the beginning part. The parados. Episodia. That's plural, by the way, for the word episode. So there are many episodes, okay? The stasimon, and then the exodus. The stasimon, it's just the final thing before the exodus. The exodus is everybody leaves the stage, okay? So the opening speech, the prologue, it kind of gives some of the exposition we need. It sets the stage, as it were. Shakespeare has a very, very famous prologue at the beginning of the play, Henry V, where a guy comes out and he says, imagine that this round O, meaning the Globe Theater, is Agincourt. You are on the fields of France. He's talking about a famous victory of the English over the French. Okay? And what he's doing is he's creating the setting verbally. Okay? So, prologue's the opening part. Then you get the parados, where the chorus makes its first entrance and gives its perspective on what the audience has learned. And then you have a bunch of episodes, or episodia, in which characters, you know, come and go and they engage in dialogue and such. Right? Following each episode is a choral ode or stasimen. That is, so whenever the chorus comes back in, you know after that first one, you're in a stasimen. You know the episode is ended, and the chorus is now in a stasimen, and it's commenting on what we've seen. Okay? And then you have the Exodus, the final scene. And it follows the final episode, the final stasimen, and we get the resolution. Where's the Exodus, and don't say at the end, where's the Exodus in Oedipus? What happens in it? Anybody remember? Louder? He sees his children. He doesn't literally see them. Because, you know, he gouged his eyes out. But yeah, he gets to see his children again. And he gives his final lines. And he leaves. Okay. Tragedy. Some of the conventions of tragedy. 1439. This is a literary definition. Literary tragedy presents courageous individuals who confront powerful forces within or outside themselves, with a dignity that reveals the breadth and depth of the human spirit in the face of failure, defeat, and even death. Okay. So a drama about love, marriage, romance is not going to be a tragedy. Why? Because you're not facing failure, defeat, and death. Romeo and Juliet could easily be a comedy. What has to happen? They don't kill each other. They don't kill themselves. Okay. Why that's held up as a great romance, by the way, that play, is really twisted, man. Do you really want teenagers committing suicide because they fell in love with each other? And how many dead teenagers would there be if that's the model to be followed? It's really strange. So, Aristotle, in his Poetics, defined tragedy on the basis of the plays contemporary to him. That is, Aristotle, who's from the person from whom we get a lot of this terminology, he went to plays, he watched plays, and on the basis of what he sees, he describes these conventions. Now, what Aristotle wrote is taken to be prescriptive. This is what it ought to be like. Okay? Or maybe not now, but in Shakespeare's day it definitely was. So, the protagonist, someone who's regarded as extraordinary rather than typical or ordinary. A protagonist in a Greek drama is always somebody who's above everybody else. Okay? Not necessarily morally. And even not necessarily in terms of worth or value in that society. Okay? Antigone, for example. She's not a commoner. She's not an everybody. Why? Because she's the daughter of Oedipus. That raises her because Oedipus had been the king. It's not until the 20th century that you get protagonists who can be anybody. Great drama of the mid-20th century, Death of a Salesman by Arthur Miller, with Billy, I'm forgetting the protagonist's name. Yeah. Death of a Salesman is, pardon?
Biff, is that it?
No, that's his son. Death of a Salesman is about a salesman, a guy who makes his living carrying a suitcase from kind of door to door, business to business, hawking his wares. He's an average, ordinary slob from, I think it is the Bronx in New York. Okay. He's not better than everybody. In fact, he's a little bit kind of lower. He's kind of the lower end of middle class. He wants to be on the other side. All right? That wouldn't work in Shakespeare's day or in ancient Greek drama. Okay? So, Page 1440, top of the page. The protagonist also carries mythic significance. That is, the protagonist kind of has a larger-than-life quality about him. He or she symbolizes important things. You know, Oedipus, going against fate. Antigone, standing up to the full power of the state, for example. All right? But the tragic hero always, according to Aristotle, has a flaw. There's something about him or her that makes him or her do what they do. And it's the thing that makes them do what they do that always causes their downfall. This flaw, Aristotle called hamartia. It's the same word, by the way, that in the New Testament gets translated into English as sin. And what it means is not literally tragic flaw. It means they missed the mark. Okay? They missed the mark. Their shot misses the target. Okay? It's dangerous to call it a flaw in their character because it might not be actually a flaw. It might be a certain kind of a predisposition to act a certain way. For example, Oedipus. How does he tend to act within the play? Does he calmly look at everything? Does he reason it out before he makes a decision or judgment or action? No.
Jumps to conclusions.
He's rash. He is impetuous. You know, Creon comes back from having sought out the oracle. And Creon says, let's go inside and talk. What does Oedipus say? No, I have no secrets. What you're going to say to me, you can say out here in front of all my friends. Well, what does Creon say? The killer of Laius is going unpunished. Seek him out. And Oedipus says, if he's in my own house, let the judgment of the gods fall upon him. And the audience is sitting there going, okay, let's back up. I'm getting out of the first row because Zeus is going to get pissed. That's the audience knows that dramatic irony when they hear it. I mean, Oedipus says those words and they're like, you fool. You just called judgment down on yourself. Okay? So even though the book says, the word has frequently been interpreted to mean that the protagonist's fall is the result of an internal tragic flaw. But sometimes misfortunes aren't the result of a character flaw, but misunderstood events. See, I'm going to give you my definition of tragedy, okay, which differs slightly from the book. And my definition of tragedy doesn't apply only to literature, it applies to life. And it's easy. When someone is forced to make a decision about something that they don't have all the information they need. That's tragic. Okay? I don't mean, you know, voting for president. You've got basically every election, you've got the information you need. You've seen that person ad infinitum. You've seen them until you really would rather not see that person ever again in your life. Okay? And, you know, I mean all the candidates. You go through the primary season, it's like, you know, just go away, please. Okay? No. I mean those big decisions. Okay? Should I take this job? Should I ask this person to marry me? Should I X, Y, or Z? Okay? It's those big shoulds, those obligations. Do you ever really have all the information you need to make the right decision? When do you get that information? After you've made the decision. And you go back and look at it and say, we're going to read a poem by Robert Frost next week called The Road Not Taken. That's all about that kind of decision-making process. Okay? Page 1440. Often, people will say the tragic flaw of any tragic hero is hubris, spelled either H-U-B-R-I-S or H-Y-B-R-I-S, okay, which gets defined as overweening pride, super arrogance, in other words. I can do everything. Okay. I'm going to use a political example today. Don't take this the wrong way. But this statement by this politician was an example of overweening pride. When President Obama was candidate Obama, and he said, we will look back on this and say, this is the day when the ocean started to recede. In other words, if you elect me for president, the oceans will start to recede, the air will become cleaner. That's overweening pride. That's, you know, saying one person can heal the... Sorry, I don't care how brilliant you are. Not one person is responsible for that. You know, unless you're God. Okay. So overweening pride. If there's one thing the Greek gods don't like, it's arrogance. You don't step on the gods' toes. You don't step on the gods' territory. Here's a little example from Greek fiction. Got to make sure my battery doesn't die. You know the phrase, roll out the red carpet? You know, you see the Oscars and you have all the famous people walking on the red carpet? Okay. If we lived in ancient Greece society and they were smart, none of them would walk on the red carpet. Why? Because the red carpet is an image that's reserved for the gods. And we have a Greek play called Agamemnon. It's part of what's called the Oresteia, three plays written by Euripides. And in Agamemnon comes back from the Trojan War. He's been gone for 10 years. Okay, little background. In order to go to the Trojan War, he had to sacrifice his daughter. God said, we're not going to let you go until you give us your daughter. And by give, I mean, you know, he had to kill her. Okay, so he sacrifices his daughter. Doesn't make his wife, Clytemnestra, all that happy. Goes off to the Trojan War, fights for 10 years, comes back, and his wife and her boyfriend, his right-hand man, who stayed behind to look after the kingdom, they roll out the red carpet for Agamemnon. Okay, he's come home a conquering hero. And he strides down that red carpet into the hall, into their house, where Clytemnestra and her boyfriend kill him. Okay? Now, from the gods' perspective, that killing is justified. Why? Because he walked on the red carpet. He thought he was a god because of what he did in the Trojan War. Okay? And then you have a whole bunch of other stuff that happens as a result of that. Okay? 1441. Why do we go see plays? Or more specifically, Aristotle said, why do we go see tragedies? So that they purge us of pity and fear. The purging is this catharsis. In other words, it has a cathartic effect. Why do people love today to go see big action movies? What happens in those action movies? Or sometimes horror movies? Okay, tragic events. What happens to you in the theater?
A release of tension.
Okay, but before you get that release, you get that buildup. If you ever saw the movie Jaws in the theater, I saw it when I snuck in. I saw it when I was 15. It came out in 77. It was an R-rated film. saw it when I was 15, you know, and you're in there and you have the ocean and the girls swimming at night, and then, you know, you see her jump up and down, and then you get this scene where these guys are diving and they find this boat sunk, okay? And they're looking around, and all of a sudden, this head pops out. Okay, what does that do? That's building all of this terror, okay? Why? Because by the end of the film, what's going to happen? It's going to be released. You're going to be purged of that. That's why in an action film, you have the bad guy. The bad guy sets all this horrible stuff into effect or into motion. And what is it up to the good guy or good guys to do? To resolve it, to stop the bad guy's things from happening. Okay? So that you walk out of the film going, okay? It's feeling manipulation. Okay? So Aristotle said, you get this purgation of the emotions of pity and fear. Why do we need the purgation of emotions of pity and fear? Because we are meant in a tragedy to identify with the tragic hero. We are meant to say, there but for the grace of God go I. In other words, if I were in this situation, how would I have behaved differently than Oedipus? Think about that for a moment. Put yourself in Oedipus's skin. You've been told you are fated to kill your father and sleep with your mother. Who does Oedipus grow up with? Polybus and Merope. He thinks they're his parents. He doesn't want to kill dear old dad, and he really doesn't want to sleep with mom. And so what does he do? He runs away. What's the knowledge he doesn't have that he needs to know to make a right decision? Adopted. And so what does he do? He runs from what he thinks is the situation directly into it. Okay? That's the problem with fate. If it is fated to happen, what does that mean? It will happen, no matter what you do. Oedipus is trying to make an end run around the gods. Tricked you. You don't see so well that far into the future. Who got the final laugh? Okay. So, page 1441. Nevertheless, tragedies are disturbing. That is, even after you get this purgation of pity and fear. Even at the end, there should be something in a real tragedy that makes you go, wow, that's disturbing. Okay? Aristotle described the moment in the plot when this change occurs. That is, when our expectations are changed as the reversal. The point when the hero's fortunes turn in an unexpected direction. Where does that come in Oedipus? Let me put it this way. Where does that come in Oedipus for Oedipus? Yeah, it's when the messenger comes. And the messenger says, that's why you left home? You thought Polybus and Merope were your parents? No, man, you never knew. You're adopted. And he goes, oh, Lord, no. Because what has Yocasta already done? She's heard Oedipus talking, and she's like, yuck. And she's already left the scene. Okay? So the messenger reveals previously unknown information that eventually results in a recognition. That's when Oedipus realizes exactly what he's done. Okay? Dramatic irony and tragic irony. Tragedy is typically filled with ironies. Why? Because there are so many moments in the plot when what seems to be turns out to be different from what is really happening. Dramatic irony, the meaning of a character's words or actions is understood by the audience, but not by the character. For example, Oedipus's opening speech. Okay? So, let's turn to Oedipus. Oedipus the King, written about around 430. So we get the stage directions at the beginning. Royal House of Thebes, double doors, etc. Oedipus comes out and says, why are you all here? Why are you standing in front of my house? I am Oedipus. It's, you know, what's he doing? He's saying, I will solve your problems. Don't pray to the gods. He's almost like he's saying, pray to me. Speak up, old man, your ears, your dignity. I'll do whatever I can. And so the priest says, well, look around you. Crops are dying. Firstborn are dying, etc. So now, line 39, page 1444, we pray to you. You cannot equal the gods. We know that. But we do rate you first of men, both in the common crises of our lives and face-to-face encounters with the gods. You freed us from the Sphinx. What was the riddle of the Sphinx? What walks on four legs in the morning, two legs in the afternoon, three legs in the evening? Man. Oedipus was the only one who could solve that. The Sphinx set itself up outside the gates of Thebes after Laius died. People would come because they wanted to become king of Thebes. And the Sphinx said, you can become king of Thebes, but you have to answer my question first. And if they didn't know, the Sphinx ate them. And Oedipus sits there, man, walks on four, crawls in the morning, two legs as a man, and in the afternoon, he uses a cane or a stick. Solves the riddle. So now again, Oedipus King, we bend to you your power. We implore you, all of us on our knees, find us strength, rescue. And he says, don't worry, I'm already looking into it. That's why I sent Creon off to the oracle at Delphi. Okay? The oracle at Delphi, this place still exists, by the way. We know exactly where it is. It is a place where gases come from the ground. And they now think, they thought it was an oracle because some people, they're not necessarily asphyxiated, but they get knocked unconscious by some of these gases at times. And they think they probably had hallucinations because of it. But the oracle had on a stone in front of it the words, know thyself. Okay, this kind of wisdom. And the priest says, well, look, here comes Creon right now. And Oedipus says, Oedipus appeals to Apollo. Lord Apollo, let him come with a lucky word of rescue, shining like his eyes. Okay? Creon, I have news. I have message from the god. I tell you even the hardest things to bear. If they should turn out well, all would be well. Well, but what were the god's words? Line 100. There's no hope and nothing to fear in what you've said so far. Well, if you want my report in front of all these people, I'm ready now, or we can go inside. What is Creon attempting to do? He's being diplomatic. He's saying, now I think what I have is for your ears only. Speak out. Speak to us all. I grieve for these, my people, far more than I fear for my own life. That's dramatic irony. Because the audience knows, you better fear for your own life. Okay, I'll tell you what I heard from the god. Drive the corruption from the land. Don't nurse it in your soil. Root it out. Oedipus is like, What corruption? What are you talking about? Banish the man or pay back blood with blood. Murder sets the plague storm on the city. Who's murder? Our leader, my lord, was once a man named Laius before you came and put us straight on course. Yeah, I know, I've heard the story. Okay. Well, he was killed. And Apollo commands us now, pay the killers back. Well, where are they? Where to find them? How are we going to find them? They're in Thebes. Here in Thebes. Where? Notice the first place he suggests. Oedipus. Here? Where? In the palace? The fields? Foreign soil? Where did Laius die? He went to consult an oracle and never came home again. What, no messenger came? No, everybody was killed, all but one. He escaped, terrified, wouldn't tell us anything. Well, what's that? One thing could hold the key to it all. He said thieves attacked them. A whole band. A thief. Who'd kill a king? Wow. Cram, but with Laius dead, no leader appeared to help us in our troubles. Trouble? Your king was murdered. Royal blood. What stopped you from tracking down the killer? Well, the Sphinx did. So notice what we're getting. Exposition. Background to the story. Okay? So, Oedipus addresses the priests, says, come on, quickly, up from the steps, take up your branches now, summon the whole city before us, and then the chorus comes in. So what's the chorus doing? This is its paradox. It's its first entrance, okay? And the chorus comes in, and it is a long speech, which I'm going to skip over. Line 245, Oedipus, you pray to the gods? Let me grant your prayers. That's a bit of hubris there. Do what the plague demands, you'll find relief. And so what does he say? I will speak out now as a stranger to the story, a stranger to the crime. Dramatic irony again. He says, well, if I've been present then, there would be no mystery. Okay, so he goes on. And he says, if anybody knows who the murderer is, speak up. I'll give you a reward. There's silence. But if you keep silent, because you're afraid, I order you, every citizen of the state where I hold throne and power, banish this man, that is, this murderer, whoever he may be. Don't shelter him. Never let the holy water touch his hands. Drive him out, each of you, from every home. He is the plague, the heart of our corruption. So I honor my obligations. I fight for the god and for the murdered man. And then he utters his curse on the murderer. Whoever he is, a lone man unknown in his crime or one among many, let that man drag out his life in agony. Step by painful step. I curse myself as well. And the audience is going, damn straight you do. If by any chance he proves to be an intimate of our house, here at my hearth with my full knowledge, may the curse I just called down on him strike me. Oedipus lives a natural life. He dies of old age in the play Oedipus at Colonus. And at the end of Oedipus at Colonus, Oedipus is made into a god. By the gods, because he has suffered so much. So the gods kind of say, wow, that makes him worthy to be like us. Where do the gods ever suffer? They don't. Well, I'll take that back. Zeus might suffer every now and then from not getting his way with the human that he wants, you know. But other than that, they don't suffer. We suffer because of the gods, according to the Greek thought. So, these are your orders. Perform them to the last. I command you for the sake of Apollo, for me, for this country. Find him, essentially. And the leader of the chorus essentially speaks up. He says, I'm not him. I'm not the murderer. Can't point him out. But, you know, maybe Apollo should name the killer. Apollo seems to know who it is. Oedipus, you're right. But, you know, who's going to force the gods to act against their will? No man has the power. Well, then, okay, can I suggest something? Go ahead. Tiresias, line about 323. Lord Tiresias sees with the eyes of Lord Apollo. If we could get Tiresias to come in, the blind prophet, maybe he could tell us what Apollo knows. He says, don't worry, I'm ahead of you. I've sent the escorts twice within the hour. In other words, I've already thought of that. Okay? So the leader talks about rumors. What rumors? Laius was killed, they say, by certain travelers. Yeah, I heard that. But if the man has a trace of fear in him, he's not going to stay silent. He didn't flinch at murder. He'll not flinch at words. So Tiresias comes in, being led by a boy. Look at Oedipus's address to Tiresias. And I'm going to keep going. If you need to get up and use the restroom, feel free to get up and walk out. O Tiresias, master of all the mysteries of our life, all you teach and all you dare not tell, signs in the heavens, signs that walk the earth, blind as you are, you can feel all the more what sickness haunts our city. You, my Lord, are the one shield, the one savior we can find. Now that's a pretty good way of being addressed, right? Does he think lowly of Tiresias? Does he suggest anything negative about him? Nope. He's saying, you're the only one who can help us. Tell us. Relief from the plague can only come one way. Uncover the murders of Laius. And look at Tiresias' reply. How terrible to see the truth when the truth is only pain to him who sees. Tiresias is blind, so how does he see? Notice what Sophocles is doing there with that idea of sight. Sight isn't necessarily vision. Sight is what? Understanding, exactly. It's perception. It's awareness. Okay? So, what has he said? He said, how terrible to perceive or understand the truth when the truth is only pain to the one who understands. I wasn't going to come. I never would have come. What? Send me home. You bear your burdens and I'll bear mine. Tiresias is saying, I really don't want to reveal what I know. It is a burden, he says. It is painful, he says. It's better that way. Please believe me. Oedipus, strange response. Unlawful! Why unlawful? Because Oedipus is the king and he commanded him. Unfriendly too to the state that bred and raised you. You're withholding the word of God. I fail to see that your own words are so well-timed. What's Tiresias starting to hint at? Maybe you should expand on the Erd's way of the Agge speaking. For the love of God, don't turn away. Not if you know something. We beg you, all of us on our knees. None of you knows. Tiresias is saying, I'm the only one who knows the truth of this situation. And he's willing to do what? Take it to the grave. I will never reveal my dreadful secrets, not to say your own. Now that's Tiresias' little way of code of saying, don't go there, Oedipus. Don't push. What? You know and you won't tell? You're bent on betraying us, destroying Thebes? I'd rather not cause pain for you or me. Notice now, he said three times, for you. Is Oedipus listening?
No.
Nothing? You scum of the earth. Go back to the previous page. You, my lord, are the one shield, the one savior we can find, you scum of the earth. I mean, you know, it took him, what, 3 minutes to go from one statement to the other? You didn't rage your heart of stone. You won't talk. Out with it once for all. You criticize my temper? Unaware of the one you live with? Ooh, he's just insinuated something. You revile me? Who could restrain his anger hearing you? What outrage? You spurn the city? What will come, will come, even if I shroud it all in silence. Tiresias is saying there, fate will out. In other words, fate will reveal what's going to happen. Tiresias is saying, even if I keep my mouth shut, guess what? It's going to be revealed. What will come? I'll say no more. Build your anger to whatever, rage your worst. Oh, I'll let loose. I have such fear in me now. Notice what Oedipus does. Okay, you might get a paperback where you make a statement in the first part of a sentence, and then you have a comma, and then you make another statement. You'll say something because, and I might put on that second part of the statement the Latin phrase, non sequitur, which means it does not follow. For example, I went to the store because I like green. I would put non sequitur. What does the fact that you like green have anything to do with going to the store? Are you going to buy green? You know. Okay. I see it all. What does Oedipus do? He jumps to a huge conclusion. You helped hatch the plot. You did the work. Yes. Short of killing him. Why, I'd say you did the killing single-handed if you had eyes. Tiresias, really? Is that where we're going? Is that so? I charge you then, submit to that decree you just laid down. That decree about being the scorn of the city, that decree about suffering agony all your life. From this day onward, speak to no one, not the citizens nor myself. In other words, the banishment. You are the curse, the corruption of the land. Oh, are you shameless? Okay, Tiresias is speaking truth, right? You wanted the truth? Here it is. What's Oedipus think? What's Tiresias trying to do? Deflect the blame. Oedipus thinks, you're involved. You helped plot the murder. You're just trying to push it off now. You think you can get away with this? I have already. In other words, I already said it. And where are they speaking? Inside Oedipus's private chambers? No, in front of the whole city. Who primed you for this? Not your prophet's trade. What? Excuse me, you did. You forced me. What? Say it again so I can understand it better. Oh, you didn't understand just now? No, I can't say I grasped your meaning. Out with it again. I say you are the murderer you hunt. It's twice now you said that. Well, you just told them to. Okay. Shall I say more so you can really rage? In other words, do you want to be really, really angry? Because I can tell you more. Oh, go ahead. No, you can't imagine. Dot, dot, dot. I tell you, you and your loved ones live together in infamy. You cannot see how far you've gone in guilt. You don't think you're going to suffer for this, do you? Well, if the truth has any power, It does not. It does, but not for you, old man. You've lost your power. Stone blind, stone deaf, senses, eyes blind as stone. Oedipus, you're blind. You are lost in the night, endless night that nursed you. You can't hurt me or anyone else who sees the light. You can never touch me. What does Oedipus mean by that?
He's invincible.
Yeah, I'm the king. I am so far above you. A little stingy gnat like you can't bother me at all. Tiresias, true. It's not your fate to fall at my hands. Apollo's quite enough. Creon. Is this conspiracy his or yours? Notice the other big conclusion Oedipus jumps to. Ah, the two of them together. Creon is not your downfall. No, you are your own. And Oedipus goes on for a little bit. And notice what he calls Tiresias on 1454. Come here, you pious fraud. Tell me, when did you ever prove yourself a prophet? Okay, he began by saying, oh, what a great prophet he sees into the dark, blah, 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 blah. And now he starts hurling accusations. You think you'll stand by Creon when he's king on 455? And again, notice what he's doing. I see, you and Creon got into this together. Creon said, we'll depose Oedipus, I'll be king, and I'll give you a whole bunch of stuff. That's what you did, isn't it? And notice what the leader does. I'd suggest his words were spoken in anger. Oedipus, yours too. That's not what we need. In other words, kind of simmer down, guys. They're trying to resolve the conflict. Best solution to the oracle, the riddle posed by God. We should look for that. The king. You are the king, no doubt. But in one respect, I at least am your equal. The right to reply. You can't shut me up. I'm not your slave. I serve Apollo. And I don't need Creon to speak for me. Okay, so you mock my blindness. Let me tell you something. You, with your precious eyes, you're blind to the corruption of your life. To the house you live in, those you live with, who are your parents? Now, if Oedipus were smart, he would say, who are my parents? Non sequitur, man. What does that have to do with anything? Except Oedipus knows the prophecy. Do you know? All unknowing. What's a modern word for unknowing? Ignorant. Notice, ignorant is not a bad word. Okay? It simply means you don't know. I'm ignorant when it comes to quantum physics. I'm ignorant when it comes to quantum mechanics. Okay? Just means I don't know. All unknowing, you are the scourge of your own flesh and blood, the dead below the earth and the living here above. And the double lash of your mother and your father's curse will whip you from this land one day, and their footfall treading you down in terror, darkness shrouding your eyes that now can see the light. Soon, soon, you'll scream aloud. It's like Creon, if he had a watch, is saying, tick-tock, tick-tock, tick-tock. Now, smear me with your insults. Creon, myself, every word I've said. Come on, go ahead. Oedipus, get him out. Get out. I wouldn't have come if you hadn't called for me. If I thought you'd blurt out such absurdities, you'd have died waiting before I'd had you summoned. Absurd? Not to your parents. Notice he keeps coming back to that. The ones who bore you found me sane enough. What? Wait, who is my father? Oh, what did Tiresias do? He planted a little seed of doubt. Why? What are we going to hear later in the play? A drunk comes to Merope and Polybus' house in what town? Corinth. And says at a feast, while he's drunk, they're not really your parents. And Oedipus hears that. And now, because this is later than that, now, Tiresias, who are your parents? Who's my father? This day will bring your birth and your destruction. Riddles! Riddles! But aren't you the best man alive at solving riddles? Come on, riddle master. Mock me for that. Go on, you'll reveal my greatness. Okay. So Tiresias tells his boy, take me home. Yes, take him away. Tiresias goes. But he doesn't go without speaking. He gives a little speech. And notice, before he finishes his speech, Oedipus steps inside the palace. So he doesn't hear this part. Revealed at last, brother and father both, to the children he embraces, to his mother, son, and husband both. He sewed the loins his father sewed. He spilled his father's blood. Now, Tiresias has just told us, what, 3 pages into the novel, into the play? The utter truth. Go in, reflect on that. Chorus comes in. Okay? It's the first stasimen. And the chorus tells some stuff. And what does the chorus tell us about Tiresias? The skilled prophet. What do we find out? Tiresias hasn't been wrong before. So you don't want to start hurling accusations at Tiresias. And then they go on and they talk about the gods. They understand the dark things of human life. We? No. We live in the dark. So Creon comes in. He says, I heard Oedipus said some things about me. I had to come. If in the present crisis he thinks he suffers any abuse from me, anything I've done or said that offers him the slightest injury, I've no desire to linger out this life. My reputation is shambles. In other words, Creon says, if I've done something wrong, I don't want to go on living. Let me die. Leader, true, but a slur might have been forced out of him. Again, notice what the leader's trying to do. He's trying to kind of smooth, can't we all just get along? Creon, but the charge was made in public, right? Did I put the prophet up to spreading lies? Yeah, such things were said. Oh, I don't know with what intent. Really? You don't know with what intent? Was his glance steady? That is, did Oedipus look Tiresias in the eyes, or was his head kind of bobbing all around, you know, Stevie Wonder-ish? His mind right when the charge was brought against me? Well, I really couldn't say. Again, the leader's just trying to protect himself. The leader doesn't want to get in trouble. Oedipus comes out. You here? You have the gall to show your face before the palace gates, plotting to kill me, to kill the king. Tell me in God's name, what did you take me for? Coward or fool? Aren't you the fool, you and your high adventure? Creon just kind of sits there. Are you quite finished? What does he mean by that? Yeah, you got it all out. You spilled all that bile. It's your turn to listen. For just as long as you've, how do I want to term this? Instructed me. Hear me out. Judge me on the facts. You've a wicked way with words, Crayon, but I'll be slow to learn from you. I find you a menace. Just chill out. Hear me out on this. Okay, but don't tell me you're not the enemy, the traitor. Hold on. If you think crude, mindless stubbornness such a gift, you've lost your sense of balance. If you think you can abuse a kinsman and then escape the penalty, you're insane. Fair enough. But this injury you say I've done you, what is it? In other words, Crayon is saying, I want to hear the words exactly from your mouth. Did you induce me, yes or no, to send for the sanctimonious prophet? A little bit of background. I did. It was Crayon who went to Oedipus and said, you know, maybe we should see what Tiresias has to say. And I'll do the same again. Okay, all right. How long has it been since Laius? Laius, what did he do? Why does Crayon ask that? Okay, why else? Crayon's saying, what in the world does Laius have to do with this? Laius is dead. What did he do? Vanished, swept from sight, murdered in his tracks. The count of the years would run you far back. In other words, man, that was a long time ago. Do we know how far back? Oedipus's two sons are grown and have left the city. So over 20 years. Huh. Okay. Skilled as he is today and just as honored. Count of the years would run you far back. And that far back, Oedipus asks, was the prophet out of his trade? Yep. Skilled as he is today and just as honored. He was just as good then and he was just as honored then. Okay. Did he ever refer to me then? Nope. Not when I was around him, in his presence. You did investigate the murder, right, of Laius? We did our best. Discovered nothing. But the great seer never accused me then? Why not? I don't know. Why don't you ask him? You do know this, and you'd tell it too if you had a shred of decency. What? Crayon still, he's not quite clear on the charges. Simply this, if the two of you had never put heads together, we'd never have heard about my killing Laius. If that's what he says, well, you know best. What does he mean? Well, you know best. Louder page? He means, you, Oedipus, you know whether you killed a man or not. That's it. It's like, you know, a grade school classroom, somebody steals something from somebody else, and the teacher says, okay, we're all going to do X, Y, or Z until the culprit confesses. If it's a class of 20 children, 19 of them are innocent. There's nothing, I mean, you could torture them, yes, and one of them might say, yes, I did it, even though they didn't. But the one who did it knows, right, whether or not he or she did it. So Crayon says, okay, but now I have a right to learn from you, as you just learned from me. You're married to my sister, right? Which makes Crayon what? Oedipus's brother-in-law.
And uncle.
Slash. Uncle. Yeah, right? And you rule the land with her, with equal power. Yes. And I'm the third. All of us are equals. Yes. And that's where you betray your family. Crayon's like, no, hold on, stick with me here. I want you to think this through logically. So, look at it this way. Who in his right mind would rather rule and live in anxiety than sleep in peace? Particularly if he enjoys the same authority. Not me. What's Crayon saying? I have equal power and authority as you, but what does Crayon not have to do? He doesn't have to make any of the hard decisions. Oedipus is the king, not Crayon. This would be like having, you know, two presidents, But only one of them does anything. The other one merely gets to fly in Air Force One all the time and go all around and play golf and do all kinds of fun stuff. Doesn't have to make any life or death decisions. Doesn't have to negotiate with Congress. Doesn't have to worry about war. So what's Crayon saying? Who in his right mind would give up the gig I have? I have everything. How could kingship please me more than influence power without a ball? You want proof? That is, you want proof that Tiresias and I didn't do this? Go to Delphi yourself. Go ask the god yourself. Examine the oracle. See if I've reported the message word for word. And this too. If you detect that I and the clairvoyant have plotted anything in common, arrest me, execute me. What's he saying? Prove it! And then kill me. Okay? Leader, whoa, good advice, Lord. Sound logic, good reason. Maybe you should listen. When my enemy moves against me quickly, plots in secret, I move quickly too. I plot and pay him back. So, Crayon asks, what do you want? You want me banished? No, I want you dead. A little extreme, okay. Why, because of a grudge? You don't think I'm serious? I think you're insane. Quite sane. And they go on back and forth. And then Jocasta comes in. Or you can pronounce her name Jocasta or Jocasta. She comes in. She hears the shouting. And she says to Oedipus, you in the palace now. Speaking like what? A mom. Okay. Crayon, go home. And he says, have you heard what your husband's been saying? And Crayon says, never let me die and be damned if I've done you any wrong you charge with. And so Jocasta says, Oedipus, believe it. Honor the solemn oath he swears to him, and do it for me and for the sake of all your people. And the chorus begins to chant. Okay. So Oedipus and Jocasta now start to talk. And the chorus. And Jocasta says, bottom of page 1461, come on, tell me what's going on. Why the rage? And Oedipus tells her what Tiresias said, page 1462. You listen to a prophet? Don't worry about it. Here's what a prophet's going to tell you. For example, one day, a prophet came to Laius and me, and the prophet said, guess what? That doom would strike him down at the hands of a son, our son, to be born of our own flesh and blood. But Laius, so the report goes, was killed by strangers, thieves at a place. But my son, well, he wasn't 3 days old. The father took him, fastened his ankles, had a henchman fling him away on a barren, trackless mountain. Okay. Fastened his ankles means he had a pin driven through one ankle, through the other ankle. Okay. Oedipus means club foot. He ought to go, damn, at that point.
That makes sense because he had a limp when he walked in.
Exactly, he has a limp when he walks in. So she says, there you see? See what prophets will get you? So this prophet told us, our own son's going to kill him and will grow up and will marry me. That baby was killed when he was 3 days old. Oedipus, that's strange. My mind wandered, my thoughts racing back and forth. Why are his thoughts racing back and forth? Because he remembers the prophecy he had been told. Well, I thought I heard you say Elias was cut down at a place where three roads meet. Uh-huh, that's right. Place called Phocis, where two branching roads, one from Delphi, come together. So you have a thing that looks like that. When? Why does he ask when and how long ago? Because he remembers killing a guy in a place like this. Harold's no sooner reported Lys dead than you appeared. Big flashing neon lights, you know. My God, what have you planned to do to me? Is this the moment of recognition? It's beginning. He's starting to have an inkling. What? What haunts you? No. Describe Lys. Swarthy. Gray had just begun to streak his temples. Build, kind of like you. No. I think I've just called down a dreadful curse upon myself. I simply didn't know. What are you talking about? I have a terrible fear the blind seer can see. I'll know in a moment. One more thing. What? Did he go with a light or heavy escort? Several men at arms, like a lord or a king? There are five in the party. I can see it all now. He sees. Does he have his proof? Does he know 100%? No. What needs to happen before he can fully know? The shepherd's got to come and say, oh no, I didn't kill the kid. In fact, I recognize you. You're the messenger. When the messenger says, yeah, this is the guy I got the baby from. Who told you all this? A servant, reached home, lone survivor. So he's in the palace? Nope. Soon as he returned, saw you on the throne, he skedaddled. Can we bring him back? Well, yeah, we can, but why? I'm afraid, Yocasta. And she says, okay, that'll come. But even I have a right, I'd like to think, to know what's torturing you. And so Oedipus tells us backstory. My father was Polybus, king of Corinth. My mother, Dorian, Meribid. I was held a prince of the realm. And he says, some man at a banquet who had drunk too much shouted out that I am not my father's son. Fighting words. But he says, I had to know. So, unknown to my parents, I set out for Delphi. The god Apollo spurned me, sent me away. But first, he did what? He flashed before me a vision of the future. And he can hear him cry, you are fated to couple with your mother. You will bring a breed of children into the light no man can bear to see. You will kill your father, the one who gave you life. He said, I heard that and I ran. And I ran. And I came to the very spot where the great king, you say, met his death. I began to see a herald, a brace of colts, drawing a wagon, a man, as you described him, coming face to face. I struck him in anger. And the old man, watching me, coming up along his wheels, he brings down his prod, two prongs, straight at my head. I killed him. Short work, by God. I killed them all. Every mother's son. But if there's any blood tie between Lys and this stranger, what man alive more miserable than I? And when he says if there's any blood tie, he means if this man is Lys, I'm screwed. All these curses, no one but I brought down these piling curses on myself. And you, his wife, I've touched your body with these. The hands that killed your husband cover you with blood. Wasn't I born? Notice, that's what kind of freaks him out. The hands that killed your husband have touched you. How about, I'm your son? Talk about screwing up your mind. I am abomination. The leader. My Lord, you fill our hearts with fear. But hold off. Wait till you question the witness. Oedipus, that's it. He's my last hope. I'm waiting for the shepherd. He's crucial. Why? Because the shepherd holds all the answers. Because the shepherd can say, no. He was killed by five people. It was a band of robbers. And then Oedipus can go, wasn't me. Oedipus, you said thieves. He told you a whole band of them murdered lives, right? So if he still holds to the same number, I cannot be the killer. Jocasta, don't worry about it. Apollo was explicit. Line 945. My son was doomed to kill my husband. My son. But they destroyed him first. The chorus chimes in. Destiny! Jocasta comes in, carrying a suppliant's branch, round and wool. The messenger arrives for Oedipus. And Jocasta says, where are you from? 1024, Corinth. I'll give you the message in a moment. You'll be glad of it. Well, what kind of message is this? A good message? They want to make Oedipus king of Corinth. Isn't Polybus still in power? No. He died. So, Polybus is dead? Well, if not, then strike me dead too for not telling the truth. So what's Jocasta think? Oedipus is safe. Why? He didn't kill his father. His father died. Go. She sends a servant. Get your master. Oedipus comes out. And the messenger tells him, Polybus is dead and gone. Line 1049. How? Murder? Sickness? A light tip of the scales put old bones to rest. In other words, he was really old. Sickness, then. So, see, Oedipus, I told you, Jocasta says. See where this prophecy got you? Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. I should have. Why should a man fear? Jocasta, top of 1469. It's all chance. Chance rules our lives. Not a man on earth can see a day ahead, groping through the dark. Better to live at random, best we can. And as for this marriage with your mother, don't worry about it. Why? And this is what Freud bases his entire theory of psychoanalysis on. Many a man before you in his dreams has shared his mother's bed. It's the Oedipus complex. Take such things for shadows. Nothing at all. Live, Oedipus, as if there's no tomorrow. Oedipus, well, you know, brave words. And you'd persuade me if mother weren't still alive. He and Jocasta go back and forth, and the messenger says, excuse me, wait. Who's this woman who makes you so afraid? Merope, wife of Polybus, the queen. Why are you afraid of her? Well, a prophecy sent by the gods. Could you tell me? He says, no, Apollo told me once. It's my fate. I must make love with my own mother, shed my father's blood. So for years, I've stayed away from Corinth. You're afraid of that kept you out of Corinth? Wouldn't it keep you out of them? Well, I can get rid of that old worry. You'll have a rich reward. You don't know. What do you mean? If you ran away from them, always dodging humble, yeah, you'd be covered with guilt from both your parents. That's right. Don't you know? You've nothing to fear. I'm their son. Polybus was nothing to you. Not blood. What are you saying? Polybus was not my father, no more than I am. He and I are equals. What do you mean? He was no more your father than I am. Then why did he call me his son? You were a gift years ago. He took you from my hands. How could he love me so? He loved me. Yes, he did. For years they were without child. And that made him love you all the more. And where did you get me? By accident? I stumbled on you down the woody flanks of Kithaeron. So close. Kithaeron is just outside the city of Thebes. And what were you doing? Just passing through? I was watching over my flocks, grazing them. A herdsman, okay. And your savior. What? You picked me up? Well, no, your ankles. They tell the story. Look at them. Why remind me of that? It's like he's saying, why remind me of the fact that I'm disfigured? Well, what do you mean? They were pinned together. I set you free. I've had it from the cradle, and you got your name from that misfortune, too. The name's still with you. Dear God, who did it? Father? Mother? I don't know. The one who gave you to me, he could tell. Who was that? A shepherd. He called himself, he was a servant. What was that guy's name? Larry? Leo? No. Laius. Jocasta turned sharply. The king of the land who ruled here? Yep, that was him. Herdsman was his man. Is he still alive? Can I see him? Jocasta's like, Oedipus, don't ask any more questions. Just shut up. Remember the epigraph at the beginning by Sophocles? Not all things are to be discovered. Many are better concealed. Don't ask the old shepherd, etc. And so Oedipus says, no, bring him here. And the old shepherd comes in after the chorus. And Oedipus asks, so what do you do? Herd flocks. Better part of my life. Where? Kithaeron. You ever seen this man? This is page 1473. He points to the messenger. What do you mean? Doing what? Have you ever had dealings with him? No, not that I can say. Messenger. Well, of course he doesn't know me, master. Let me refresh his memory. Shepherd. Yeah, maybe. That's a long time ago. Tell me. You gave me a child back then. Do you remember? What? Why bring that up again? Shut your mouth, damn you. Oedipus, don't yell at him. You want to answer? He's talking nonsense. The guard sees the shepherd. And what does the shepherd do? No more questions. No, I'm line 1284. I'm right at the edge, the horrible truth. I've got to say it. All right, his son. They said it was his son. But the one inside, your wife, she'd tell it best. Yes, yes, my king. Why? What for? To kill it, her own child? How could she? She was afraid of prophecies. They said he'd kill his parents, but you gave him to this old man. Why? Because I took pity on the baby. Oh, God. All come true. All burst to light. There's the recognition. Complete, total, unadulterated. O light, now let me look my last on you. I stand revealed. And he rushes into the palace. And what does he discover? Jocasta has hanged herself. And he goes up to her body and he takes the pins that she has on her clothes, pulls them off, takes the pointy thing out from the pin, gouges his eyes out. And the messenger has a big, long speech. And then Oedipus, the chorus, and then Oedipus comes out. And the chorus says, line 14, page 1478. Oh, the terror, the suffering for all the world to see. The worst terror that ever met my eyes. What madness swept over you. What God, what dark power leapt beyond all bounds. The agony, I am agony. Where am I going? Where on earth? Horror, darkness of darkness, etc. And Oedipus speaks to the chorus and says, dear friend, still here, standing by me, still with a care, the blind man. And the chorus says, man, this is horrible what you've done. What superhuman power drove you on? Apollo, friends, Apollo. He ordained my agonies. Actually, he didn't. The gods don't control fate in Greek mythology. Fate is up here. Then you have the gods. Fate is beyond the power of the gods. Fate doesn't control the gods. It's just beyond their power. They can see, but they can't affect fate. But the hand that struck my eyes was mine, he says. So Oedipus says, what can I ever see, 1475? What love, what call of the heart can touch my ears with joy, etc.? They keep talking back and forth. Page 1500, Oedipus is like, why should I want to keep having eyes? What I did was best, don't lecture me. Because what did he do with his eyes? How can I look my father in the eyes when I go down to death? How can I look my children into their eyes? No. Okay, he goes on, big long speech, which I'm going to skip. Because I want to get to the end. Creon comes in. Creon says, page 1481, I haven't come to mock you, Oedipus, or to criticize your failings. And he turns to the guards and says, you there, have you lost all respect for human feeling? Revere the sun, the holy fire that keeps us all alive. Never expose a thing of guilt and holy dread. What's he saying? Get him inside. He's saying it is unholy for Oedipus to be out here where everyone can see him. Oedipus, do one more thing for me, please. For your sake, not mine. Still being insistent. Drive me out of the land at once. What did he say? I will banish this person. Drive me out of the land at once. Far from sight. I would have done that already. But I wanted the god to clarify my duties. Notice Creon is saying, I'm getting directions from the god. Okay? And Oedipus says, the god said, kill me. Creon, yep, you're right, he did. But I'm verifying those orders. So Oedipus says, I command you, the woman inside, bury her as you see fit. It's the only decent thing to give your own the last rites. As for me, never condemn the city of my fathers to house my body. Not while I'm alive, no. Let me live on that mountain, or on the mountains. And he's saying also, and even when I'm dead, don't bury me here. Okay? He says, watch out for my children. The boys, at least, don't burden yourself. They're men, they'll go wherever they want. But my daughters, poor helpless girls, take care of them. In other words, they can't help being who they are. Because who are his daughters? They're also his sisters. If I could just hold them once, though, before I go. And they bring out Antigone and Ismene. And Oedipus thanks Creon. Bless you, Creon. May God watch over you for this kindness. Okay? Girls come, he feels their faces, he hugs them, kisses them. He gives them to Creon and says, you're the only father they have now. And Oedipus, Creon says, okay, you've wept enough. Come on, inside. And Oedipus is still kind of trying to control things. And Creon says, bottom of 1483, still the king? Still the master of all things? No. More. Here your power ends. And the chorus gets the final speech. People of Thebes, my countrymen, look on Oedipus. They're saying not just watch him, they're saying take note. Learn from Oedipus. He solved the famous riddle with his brilliance. He rose to power, a man beyond all power. Who could behold his greatness without envy? See, according to Aristotle, the tragic hero should be somebody that you look at and go, man, I wish I could be like that. And then when they fall, you say, man, I'm glad I'm not like that. Or, man, I hope I'm never put in the situation that person was put into. Now, what a black sea of terror has overwhelmed him. And then look at these last two lines. Now, as we keep our watch and wait the final day. What does that mean? We keep our watch and wait the final day. Until we die, what does the keep our watch? We go on living. And wait the final day. Suicide wasn't an option. The idea was, you take whatever life throws at you, and you keep going. If it knocks you down, you get up and keep going. Now, as we keep our watch and wait the final day, count no man happy till he dies, free of pain at last. Okay? Count no man happy till he dies, free of pain at last. Because to live is to endure pain. Period. Okay? Questions? Comments? Look at the kind of questions they have. Yeah, one.
Doesn't Oedipus cannot stop suffering even after death because he had taken his eyes off?
No. According to the plays, all three of them, he doesn't figure at all in, he's not in Antigone. But in the third play, because he has suffered so much, the gods turn him into a god. Okay, they say, you know, you've endured more than any human being ever. And therefore, they raise him to the level of the gods. But look at some of the questions. These are designed to help you if you wanted to consider writing a paper. Is it possible for a 21st century reader to identify with Oedipus's plight? Okay, what does that mean? None of you probably has been told you're fated to kill your father and sleep with your mother. If you have, I'm sorry. But is that really what it's about? No. So what's it about?
It's about not having control over your own destiny.
Yeah. Okay. Things happen that you don't have any control over. Yeah, you have control over a great deal of your life. You know, George Carlin used to joke about, famous American comic. George Carlin used to joke about, you know, you're on an airplane. It's not your time to die. But what if it's the pilot's time to die? Pilot has a heart attack. And automatic pilot's not on. I mean, look what happened to the German Airwings jet this past spring. Pilot steps out of the cockpit to use the restroom. Co-pilot locks the door, puts that thing into a nosedive, right into the side of the Alps. You know, the people in the back are going, whoa, I've still got time on this ticker. Okay? It's this idea of uncontrollable events. The Greeks saw uncontrollable events as fate. We don't generally talk about fate very much anymore. Okay? What else? What causes Oedipus's downfall?
He's rash.
He's rash. Okay, can you understand leaving Corinth? I'd have been on the next train out of Dodge. Yeah, I'd have been out of Corinth, you know, soon as I heard the word. But then what's the first thing apparently he does? He kills a guy who has the same build as him, who looks a little bit like him, and whose hair is graying. So if you're going to kill anybody, make sure they're younger than you or your own age. At least make it so that they're physically, biologically impossible to be your father. Okay? I mean, if you're going to kill somebody, be smart about it. It's like I used to tell, you know, students, if you're going to cheat, if you're going to plagiarize, Don't plagiarize from the books I know. Don't plagiarize from the books. I had a graduate student do this once in Mississippi. Don't copy a page out of the textbook and present it as your material. That's just really, really stupid, you know. What else? What do Oedipus's confrontations with Creon and Tiresias indicate about his character?
He's quick to turn on somebody.
It's part of the rashness. That's why I think his internal flaw is, man, he jumps to conclusions. He's rash. He's impetuous. He doesn't stop and think about things. Okay, so then translate that to today. Do you want a leader who's impetuous? You know, after 9/11, people in the American government and people in the Western world were really fearful because they thought George Bush, cowboy from Texas, he's going to launch nuclear Armageddon in the Middle East. He's just going to wipe them all out. And what does he do? He doesn't do anything for several weeks. And they're like, what's going on here? And when he does finally do something, it's in Afghanistan, you know, to go after the ultimate source kind of thing. There's not that rashness, that impetuosity. Okay? But we've had other leaders, presidents, who somebody says something and the president verbally lashes out. And then later, a press spokesman has to walk back those comments. Well, that's not really what he said. He said, somebody throws a dirty, rotten SOB. He meant, he's a dirty, rotten son of Barbie. His mother's perfect and wonderful. No. Okay. All right. Any other questions? All right. Let's do the